and generally speaking, the only vehicles that go down are a minibus or a taxi that have children with learning difficulties to work in Dale Farm. And they normally go down at 10 o'clock in the morning to 3:30 in the afternoon. Most people walk their dogs down there, and it's not wide enough for two vehicles. And my concern would be if the access is onto that lane and a vehicle is coming down, we have to reverse all the way back up onto Oldfield Road, which is quite big and does have traffic parking on either side. And I'd like to know from the highways officer what the position is for the fact that we can't get two vehicles past there. It's going to be an access. Presumably, anybody that presumably buys the property might have more than one car on the town visitors.
Thanks, Kathy.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. When I was looking at this, I went down that way to see what was going on down there, and there is a car park down by Town Farm, which is utilised by people who go and work at that farm. I took the view that this is a single residential property, so the traffic generation from this is going to be less than is generated by Dale Farm, in my view. So the instances of where cars are likely to meet each other are going to be very few and far between, so I don't feel that it's sufficient there to warrant an objection on highways terms. I did discuss this with the rights of way officer as well, because of his knowledge of this lane with being the rights of way there on there. And he's of the same opinion that I've just expressed.
Stuart?
Yeah, I think what's been discussed about is in terms of the design of what's been put up and highways and all the rest of it. However, my eye really is drawn to the policy context, which is laid out on page 93, particularly our policy GR1, which is particularly 93 and 94, which seeks to protect areas of the UDP and to designate their green space such as this. I think in general I would be unhappy with departing from GR1 because it certainly serves a purpose probably in more urban parts of the world and maybe less so in the more leafy parts of the world. But nevertheless, the policy context goes on to include NC3, which is a protected site for national reports for nature conservation and LA1 for protection of areas of special landscape value, etc. So if it wasn't bad enough that it was attempting to breach urban green space policies, it would now appear that it's attempting to breach two other policies, again aimed at protecting these sorts of sites. So notwithstanding whether cars would pass if something was built there or that it would look something made on a CAD computer, I'm unhappy with the policy concept. It's a departure with which, frankly, I'm not prepared to live. Can I just ask, in terms of the policy implications, obviously, the start of the report talks about the policies that are relevant and then it goes on to dissect them in terms of the implications. My mention is made of NC3 in the implications. I don't really want to maybe expand on those implications. I mean, my view is the implications that are laid out for the loss of the urban green space and the impact on the area of special landscape value are bad enough. But there's no mention of policy implications on page 95 of NC3, so that could be expanded.
Obviously, we took into consideration that policy because those members of the sort of site would see that it's very densely wooded and there is the potential for that site to be used by wildlife, bats, badgers, and other species. And as part of this application, as I alluded to in my presentation, there was a habitat survey done. There was a tree survey done, and specifically the issue of bats was also surveyed for. And the findings of those surveys were toxicology analysis and looked at the nature prospects of this site. And on the basis of the surveys that were submitted and the quite comprehensive response that we had back from the ASS, we felt that the sort of ecological and habitat matters of the site have been properly addressed. So that's why we haven't really detailed that issue any further, because they have been properly dealt with through these surveys and our own ecological analysis.
Okay, that's
it.
Thank you, Chair. I did attend the site visit, and I just have a few comments, really. I mean, you could talk at length about the policies that this breaches. It's pretty clear to me that even though the site itself is not accessible to the public, it is viewable by the public, so it clearly does conflict with GR1 and the prejudice of the visual amenity, and also the nature conservation value of the site. I can't see any merit in this application. If I was going to approve something like this, I would really want to see an outstanding dwelling being put forward, you know, with really strong green features, eco features that really blended in with the site. It clearly doesn't. I don't see any architectural merit in it, and it clearly breaches so many policies. So I couldn't support it.
Thank you.
just a reminder of the site visits will be on the Thursday.